If you look inside your bulletin, you'll see a copy of the outline that we'll be going through this hour, but also this will continue into the second hour. And the topic we'll be covering will be the basis of the second coming of the Messiah, or what's the one condition that must be fulfilled before Messiah can return for the purpose of setting up his messianic kingdom. Now, by way of introduction, let me point out that I'm not discussing the rapture of the church, which is quite distinctive from the second coming. The rapture of the church has no preconditions whatsoever. It can happen any moment of time, and that's part of God's program for the body of the Messiah, the Kehila, the Ecclesia, the church. But the second coming does have a major precondition, and this major precondition needs to be fulfilled before the Messiah can return for the purpose of setting up the kingdom. And we shall be dealing more specifically with the second coming and not the rapture of the church. Now, before we can begin to deal with the precondition to the second coming, we need to raise another question first, answer that before we can fully understand the precondition. And that is, what exactly happened at the time of the rejection of the Messiahship of Yeshua, the Messiahship of Jesus? And this brings us to Matthew chapter 12. You can turn your Bibles, if you wish, to Matthew chapter 12. Now, he goes public with his ministry in chapter 4 of Matthew, and from chapter 4 through chapter 12, he's going all over the land of Israel, from city to city and synagogue to synagogue, proclaiming himself to be the Messiah and authenticating his claims with many miracles and signs and wonders. And the purpose of his miracles between chapters 4 and chapter 12 were for the purpose of serving as signs for Israel to get Israel to make a decision concerning those same messianic claims. They were to authenticate two things. First of all, he is the Messiah the prophets have been predicting. And secondly, he's offering to Israel the messianic kingdom of the prophets. So if they will accept him as the messianic king, they will see the kingdom established in their day, but no such kingdom could be established until they first owned him to be that messianic king. And that is the issue between chapters 4 and chapter 12. His person, he's the Messiah, his message, he's offering them the gospel, the good news of the messianic kingdom. Now, things change beginning in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 22. Then was brought unto him one possessed with a demon, blind and dumb, and he healed them, insomuch the dumb man spoke and saw. The turning point comes in when the Messiah cast out a demon that caused the person controlled to be a mute, so he could not speak. And notice that the question this raises in the very next verse, could this be the son of David? Now, why would they raise that question? Now, before the Messiah arrived, the rabbis separated miracles into two categories. And the categories were, first of all, miracles anyone would be able to do if he was empowered by God to do so. But secondly, there was a second category of miracles which would be referred to as messianic miracles, meaning miracles only Messiah would be able to do. And there were three main miracles in that second category. I'm not sure they're on the screen or not. Before Messiah came, the rabbis divided the miracles into those, say, unique categories. And there were three main miracles in that second category. And when he performs one of those three special miracles, the Jewish reaction is always very different than when he performs miracles of the first category. These are not messianic, but these are. And the first one is the healing of a Jewish leper. The second one is healing someone that was born blind, not someone that went blind. But the third one is the one we're dealing with here, and that is casting out a mute or dumb demon. And the people were amazed, and that's when they raised the question about his messiahship. And the reason was because of the practice of rabbinic and Pharisaic exorcisms in the first century, in that Pharisees and rabbis and their disciples also practiced casting out demons. But to cast a demon, one had to use a specific ritual in rabbinic Judaism that had three specific steps. First of all, they had to establish communication with the demon. When a demon speaks, he uses the vocal cords of the person he controls. Secondly, after establishing communication with the demon, he would then have to find out the demon's name. Thirdly, once he knew what the demon's name was, then he could use that name to cast the demon out. And these were the three ancient steps of the Jewish procedure. There's one kind of demon they could never cast out, the kind of demon that caused the person to be dumb or mute so he could not speak. And therefore, they could not cast out a kind of a demon, but have been teaching before Messiah arrived that when the Messiah comes, he will even cast out a dumb or mute demon. And that is why the Jewish masses raised that question in verse 23. Could this be the son of David? Now, the Pharisees have only one of two options. Because while the multitudes are willing to raise the question, could this be the Messiah, what they're not willing to do is simply answer the question for themselves. And throughout our history, the Jewish people have tended to labor or belabor under a complex I would call the leadership complex. Whichever way the leaders go, the people are sure to follow. And this was true in biblical times. For example, throughout the Hebrew Bible, that when the king did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, the people followed. When the king did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord, they also followed. And even today, when we give the gospel to our Jewish context, eventually they'll raise the same objection. If this Jesus is the Messiah, how come our rabbis do not believe on him? And in first century Israel, because of the stranglehold that Pharisaism had upon the Jewish masses, this complex was very strong. So again, while they're willing to raise the question, could this be the son of David? They're not willing to answer the question for themselves, looking to the spiritual leaders, the Pharisees, to answer that for them. And in verse 24, the Pharisees do respond, because they only have two options. The first option is to pronounce him to be the Messiah. This they don't want to do because of his previous rejection of the authority of Pharisaic Judaism. The second option would be to reject him, but if they choose to reject him, they also have to be able to explain away why he can do those things only Messiah would be able to do. And in verse 24, they go with the second option. And verse 24 reads, "But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, 'This man does not cast out demons, but by Beelzebub, the prince of demons.'" And so they reject him as the Messiah, but to explain away why he can do those things that no one else has been able to do is by claiming that he himself is possessed, but not by a common demon, but by the prince of demons, Beelzebub. And Beelzebub, or Baal Zvuv, is a two Hebrew words meaning the Lord of the Flies, the Lord of the Flies. And this became the official basis for the rejection of his messiahship. He's not the Messiah on the basis of being demonized, being demon-possessed. And this became the official rejection of his messianic claims. In verses 25 to 45, we see the response of the Messiah. In verses 25 to 29, he points out, their accusation cannot be true because it would mean a division in Satan's kingdom. And then in verses 30 through 37, he pronounces a special judgment upon that generation of Israel, of being guilty of a very unique sin, the unpardonable sin or the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. And because the sin is what he calls it, unpardonable, a special judgment is now set down against that specific generation, a judgment that will come 40 years later with the Roman destruction of the city and the temple. And to make it even clearer, let me define exactly what the unpardonable sin is. There's only one context that this sin is mentioned. It's also mentioned in Mark and Luke, but it's the same context. Outside this context, you don't find the unpardonable sin mentioned, and it must be interpreted by virtue of the context where it is found. And by the context, we can define it as it is on your screen, the national rejection of the Messiahship of Yeshua, the Messiahship of Jesus, while he was physically present on the earth, on the basis, on the grounds of being demonized. I repeat, the national sin, the unpardonable sin, is the national rejection by Israel of the Messiahship of Jesus while he was present on the grounds of being demonized. And the unpardonable sin is what he calls it, and our judgment is inevitable that will finally come in the year 70 with the Roman destruction of the city and the temple. Let me make four ramifications to make it very clear exactly what the unpardonable sin is and what it is not. First of all, this is a national sin and not an individual sin. Individual members of that day and that generation could and did escape the judgment by becoming believers. Nor is this a sin any individual could commit today. It was not individual to begin with. And the Bible makes one thing very clear. Regardless of what sin anyone commits, every sin is forgivable to any individual that will come to God through the blood of the Messiah, as the nature of the sin is irrelevant. When he died on the cross, he didn't just die for those kinds of sins, but not for the others. He died for every kind of sin, rendering every kind of sin forgivable to any individual that will come to the Messiah through that blood of the Messiah. But for the nation as a nation, it is now unpardonable. Secondly, the sin is uniquely limited to the Jewish generation of that day and not applicable to subsequent Jewish generations that come after the year 70. It was to this Jewish generation that he visibly, physically came, offering himself as the Messiah, offering to set up the Messianic kingdom. It was this generation that rejected him. And so from now in the Gospels, you'll see those two words coming up over and over again. This generation, because this generation alone is guilty of this unique sin. So again, to summarize, this is a sin that is unique to the Jewish generation of Jesus' day and not applicable to all subsequent Jewish generations. Third ramification, although this is a national sin and no other nation could be guilty of this sin because the Messiah is not now visibly, physically present with any other nation, offering himself as that nation's Messiah. That was unique to his relationship to the people of Israel. And therefore, only Israel could be guilty of this unique sin. So again, to summarize, no other nation could be guilty of this sin. And the fourth ramification is that the commitment of the unpardonable sin by this generation for this generation means two things. First of all, it means that the offer of the Messianic kingdom is now rescinded. It's withdrawn. And they lost out on the opportunity of seeing the kingdom established in their day. And then secondly, it means that now this generation is facing a specific divine judgment. And again, that will come in the year 70 with Roman destruction of the city and the temple. Now, what has happened at this point is what's happened twice before in biblical history. When a specific generation goes beyond the point of no return, no amount of repenting can change the fact of coming physical judgment. And this is the third time this has occurred. The first time you see this happening is in the book of Numbers, chapters 13 and 14, the sin of Kadesh Barnea. Kadesh Barnea is an oasis which was right on the border of the Promised Land. So once you walk past Kadesh Barnea, that will put you inside the Promised Land. And the people of Israel finally arrived at this oasis. And from the oasis, Moses sent out 12 spies who came back 40 days later, agreeing at one point, the land is all that God said it was, the land that flows to milk and honey. But then came a crucial point of disagreement, in that Only two of the 12 spies said, "God is with us. We can take the land." But two said, "Oh no." Ten said, "Oh no, because of numerical superiority of the Canaanites and their military strength, no way we can take the land." As people often do today, they make the assumption the majority must always be right. And there was a massive rebellion against Aaron and Moses. The two men were almost killed in a mob scene till God intervened. And by that point, God decreed a judgment on the exodus generation. They would now have to continue wandering in the desert until 40 years pass. In that 40-year period, all who came out of Egypt will die out. And there'll be a new nation that was born as freemen in the desert and not the slaves in Egypt, that will be allowed to enter the promised land. So what happened is that God withdrew the offer of the promised land from that generation, the exodus generation, just as here in Matthew 12, he's withdrawing the offer of the kingdom from this generation. And just as a new generation would finally enter Israel under Joshua 40 years later, by the same token, a time will come, a time in the tribulation, when the kingdom will be reoffered to a new Jewish generation. They will accept it, the Jewish generation of the tribulation, and that then will initiate the Messianic kingdom. Now again, once a point of no return is reached, no amount of repenting can change the fact of coming physical judgment. And chapter 14 of Numbers does say the people repented. And verse 20 even says God did forgive the sin. It did not affect anyone's individual salvation. But now they had to pay the physical consequences of going beyond the point of no return, which was physical death outside the land. And we should remember, even Moses had to die outside the land because of a sin he committed, but it did not affect his individual salvation. What we're dealing here is the physical consequences have gone beyond the point of no return. The second time this happened is in the days of King Manasseh, who was the worst king Jerusalem ever had. He was guilty of shedding much blood among the Jewish believers of that day. And he even was more wicked than other wicked kings of Jerusalem. He even practiced human sacrifice. And finally, a point of no return was reached, and God decreed the Babylonian destruction of the city and the first temple, and decreed the 40 years of the world, 70 years of the captivity. Now here again, once a point of no return is reached, no amount of repenting could change the fact of coming physical judgment. And indeed, towards the end of his reign, Manasseh did repent. He became a saved man. He was followed by the righteous rule of King Josiah, who brought revival throughout the whole land. But God said he will not bring on the captivity in Josiah's day, but the judgment itself was inevitable. And so not long after Josiah's death, the Babylonians came. And now for the third time here in Matthew 12, a specific generation goes beyond the point of no return. And what that means is that no matter how many Jewish people come to believe, and by the way, myriads of Jews came to believe in the first century, it would not change the fact of the coming judgment of AD 70. The point of no return has been reached, and the judgment was now inevitable. After hearing the words of rebuke and judgment, in verse 38, the Pharisees tried to retake the offensive by asking him to show them another sign. Now, by this point of time, he performed many signs and wonders, including those unique miracles that they themselves had labeled to be uniquely messianic miracles. But now the point of no return is reached. And so in verses 39 and 40, he announces a new policy concerning the purpose of his signs. And from now on, he will no longer be performing signs for the benefit of the nation to get them to come to faith. They've now made the judgment, they've now made the sin inevitable, and the sin itself is unpardonable. So for the nation, he points out, there'll be no more signs except one sign, the sign of Jonah, the sign of resurrection. He does continue to perform many miracles after the events of Matthew 12, but the purpose of his miracles now change. No longer will the purpose of his miracles be to serve as signs to Israel to get them to make a decision. The purpose now will be for the training of the 12 disciples, for the new kind of work they'll have to conduct because of this rejection, the kind of work they'll be performing in the book of Acts. But for the nation, there'll be no more signs except one sign, the sign of Jonah, the sign of resurrection. And this sign will come to Israel three different times. First will be the resurrection of Lazarus. Secondly, will be the resurrection of the Messiah himself. And thirdly, will be the resurrection of the two witnesses in the tribulation, which will finally begin the process of Israel's national regeneration. After announcing his new policy concerning the purpose of his signs, he continues with the theme of judgment that was interrupted, but now notice the beginnings of the focus on this specific generation. Verse 41, the men of Nineveh shall stand up in the judgment with this generation and shall condemn it. Verse 42, the queen of the south shall rise up in the judgment with this generation and shall condemn it. He now brings in two Gentile examples from the Hebrew Bible, the men of Nineveh and the queen of Sheba. Now, these were Gentiles who had a lot less light to respond to, but they did respond to lesser light. And so at the great white throne judgment, these Gentiles would be able to witness against this specific Jewish generation for being guilty of rejecting the Messiah and being guilty of the unpardonable sin. Then the words of judgment conclude with another story about a demon, though the point of the story is often missed. It's found in verses 43 to verse 45. He talks about a demon that was living in a person, but then chose to leave. It was not cast out. This demon simply chose to leave on his own will, looking for a better flat in which to live. He searches for a while, but when he can find no vacancies, he decides to go back to the person who was then dwelling earlier. When he finds him again, he finds him swept in verse 44. He finds him garnished, but finds him still empty. Because in this interval period, when the man was freed of any demonic indwelling, he was not indwelled by some other spirit, be it the Holy Spirit or a demonic spirit. So because the man remained empty, this demon is able to go back in. And he doesn't want to live by himself anymore, so he invites seven of his friends to join him. And in verse 45, he points out the last state of that man is worse than the first. Because at the first, he only had one demon in him. Because he remained empty, now has eight demons in him. But the point of the story is made in the very last phrase of verse 45. Even so shall it be unto this evil generation. Notice again the focus on this specific generation. Then when this generation began, it began with the preaching of John the Baptist. And John's calling was to prepare that nation for the reception of the Messiahship of Jesus. And so the preaching of John, this generation was swept and this generation was garnished. But now with the rejection of the Messiahship, they remain empty. And because they remain empty, the last state will be worse than the first. At the first, under Roman domination, they had to pay heavy taxes and tribute to Rome. Rome allowed them to retain their ethnic identity. Jerusalem was standing. The temple was functioning all of its heroic glory. They even had a semi-autonomous government in the Sanhedrin. But 40 years after these words were spoken, the legions of Rome came. After a four-year war and a two-year siege, the city was destroyed, the temple torn down till there was not one stone on top of another, and the Jewish people dispersed throughout the world. The last state of that generation did become worse than the first. Now, the four specific results, under point three in your outline, four specific results of this particular unpardonable sin. First of all, the signs will no longer be for the benefit of the nation. From now on, they'll be training the 12 disciples for the new ministry they'll have to perform in the book of Acts. But the second result concerns the miracles themselves. Now, before Matthew 12, his miracles were for the benefit of the masses, and he did not really necessarily require them to have faith first. For example, the healing of the man at the pool of Bethesda in John chapter 5, which is an event that precedes Matthew 12. Jesus simply sought the man out and proceeded to heal him. And the man did not know who Jesus was. There was no faith on his part. He didn't even knew what Jesus was claiming to be. He had to later on go back and find out who he was. Because at this point, faith was not essential for these miracles to occur. These miracles were to get them to believe. Now that will change after Matthew 12. From now on, he'll perform miracles only for the benefit of individuals. And now he will require them to have faith first. Also part of the second result concerns the fact that before Matthew 12, he would tell people, go and proclaim what God has done for you after they've been healed of some problem. But in Matthew 20, after Matthew 12, every time he heals someone, he tells that person, don't tell anyone what I've done for you. He now initiates a policy of silence, and those who benefit from his messianic power are prohibited to tell anyone about it. And so we can summarize it this way, go from tell all to tell no one. And his miracles go from masses without faith to individuals with faith. The third result concerns the message that he and the apostles will now be proclaiming. Until Matthew 12, both he and they went all over Israel, again city to city and synagogue to synagogue, proclaiming him to be the Messiah. That changes after Matthew 12, and now he'll even prohibit his own apostles to tell anyone who he is. And so later in Matthew chapter 16, when Peter makes his famous confession and says, you are the Messiah, the Son of the God, the Living One. The Messiah tells Peter, don't tell anyone I am the Messiah. And they too must follow the new policy of silence until that is prohibited, until that is removed in Matthew 28 with the Great Commission. At that point, again, allowed to proclaim the gospel message to all. And so to summarize, he goes from proclamation of his messiahship to silence about his messiahship. And the third change has to do with the style of teaching. Until Matthew 12, he taught the people, when he taught them publicly, he taught them clearly, distinctly, in terms that they both could and did understand. And there's one example of this in Matthew 5-7, the Sermon on the Mount. And when he is finished, the people clearly understood what he was saying, and more significant, they knew where he differed with the scribes and Pharisees. But now after Matthew 12, beginning Matthew 13, he begins teaching with a new methodology. Look at chapter 13, verse 1. 13, verse 1, on that day, on what day? The same day the rejection occurred. The same day the unpardonable sin was committed. On that day, says verse 3, he spoke to them many things in parables. He now begins teaching parabolically. And in verse 10, when the disciples ask him, why are you teaching them in parables? They're not accustomed to him teaching quite that way. He said there are two reasons for the parabolic method of teaching. The first reason is for the believers, the disciples, and for them, these parables will illustrate the truth. But for the masses, the purpose will be to hide the truth, to teach them in terms that they cannot and will not understand. Because by now they received sufficient light to respond correctly, they responded incorrectly with the unpardonable sin, and no further light will be given to them. Now look at Matthew chapter 13, and look at verse 34, Matthew 13, 34. All these things spoke Jesus in parables unto the multitudes, and notice, without a parable spoke he nothing unto them. Not a parable spoke he nothing unto them. Now this is not a true statement before Matthew 12, but is absolutely true after Matthew 12. Whenever he teaches publicly, it'll always be parabolically, in terms that they will not and cannot understand. Because by this point of time, they received sufficient light to respond correctly. They responded incorrectly with the unpardonable sin, and no further light will be given to them. It's impossible to appreciate why his ministry changes so radically in these four areas, unless we see how crucial the events of Matthew 12 are. It will set the stage for the second half of the ministry. It sets the stage for the events of the book of Acts. It will set the stage for a new entity to come into being, the Kehillah, the Ecclesia, the church, the body, the Messiah. it sets the stage for Jewish history for the next 2,000 years. It's a very crucial turning point. Let's turn to one more passage before we break. Let's look at Matthew chapter 16. Even after Matthew 12, they come again, ask him to show them a sign. As in verse 1, and the Pharisees and Sadducees came, trying him, asked him to show them a sign from heaven. Now skip down to verse 4. An evil and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, there shall no sign be given unto it, but the sign of Jonah. He left them and departed. And that is his consistent answer after Matthew 12. Every time they ask for a sign, there'll be no more signs given except the sign of Jonah, the sign of resurrection. And that is the only sign he'll give them publicly, as we'll see as we continue the study a bit later. Okay, let me close with another story. It's not a rabbi story like the one last night, but it has a Jewish connection. It's about a Taliban terrorist running through the desert, fleeing the authorities. He's running out of water, getting desperate. Looks up on the horizon and he sees what might be an oasis. And if it is an oasis, there'll be water, there'll be trees. When he finally gets there, he realizes there's no trees there, there's no water there, just an old Jewish man selling ties. And the Taliban terrorist asked him, "Don't you have any water here?" And the Jewish man says, "I have no water. But look, I have all these nice ties, only $5. That terrorist says, "I don't need your Western garments. I'm an Easterner. I need some water." And Jewish man says, "Well, like I said, I have no water. But look, I have this nice silk tie, only $5. And the terrorist says, "I wish I had strength right now to take the tie and put around your neck and squeeze you till you're dead. I hate Jews. I want to kill Jews. But I need to reserve my energy. I need to find some water." The Jewish man says, "I'll show you I'm a better man than you are. You hate me because I'm Jewish, you don't buy any one of my ties. Fine, but I'll show you I'm a better man. If you just walk in a straight line between these sand dunes for about another kilometer, you'll come to a crossroads that has a nice restaurant, has all the water you could possibly want to drink. So go in peace and may God bless you." And as the terrorist leaves, he yells out, "I may come back and kill you yet, but right now I'm reserving my energy." He's gone for a while. After a while, he comes back, but he's crawling on his hands, he's crawling on his knees. He's got a $5 American dollar in his hand, and he says, "They will not let me in without a tie." I was asked to give a short synopsis of what we covered in the first hour. We focused on Matthew chapter 12, and we pointed out between chapter 4 and chapter 12, he's been traveling all over Israel, proclaiming himself to be the messianic person, the messianic king, offering to Israel the kingdom of the Jewish prophets. But in Matthew 12, he was officially rejected by the leadership of Israel. As a result, the nature of his ministry now changes in specific areas. And one of these areas is the fact that he's no longer offering to Israel the kingdom of the prophets. He'll now be training the disciples for the new kind of work they'll be conducting in the book of Acts. And we point a number of differences in that nature. If you didn't get this before, in your bulletin there is a copy of the outline. And we are now down to capital C. You can turn your Bibles to John chapter 11. There's a story of a man who went to see his rabbi and said, "Rabbi, I really believe my wife is trying to poison me." Rabbi says, "I find this very difficult to believe. You probably had another one of your fights. And you said things you should not have, and she said things she did not mean. Tell you what, you wait here in the office. I'll go talk to your wife and get the whole thing straightened out. It shouldn't take very long." The rabbi left, but he didn't come back for many, many hours. It was already pitch black outside when he returned. And he told the man, "I just spent hours and hours and hours just talking to your wife. Well, to be more correct, I just spent hours and hours and hours just listening to your wife. Take the poison." Now here we have a lot of detail, 44 verses worth of detail concerning the resurrection of Lazarus. But Lazarus was not the first person the Messiah raised from the dead. The other resurrections are covered from between 2 to 4 verses. They're witnessed to only by a few, and the few witnesses they're then told to tell no one about it. But in sharp contrast, all the other resurrections, the case of Lazarus, we have a lot of detail, 44 verses worth of detail. And in place of being witnessed to by the few, this one is witnessed to by the many. As we shall see, the multitudes are present. So what makes this miracle unique? It's unique in that this is the one sign he still promised to give them publicly after Matthew 12, the sign of Jonah, the sign of resurrection. And when this sign is given, they will need to respond. And once we understand the role the resurrection of Lazarus plays in the relationship of Israel, of Jesus as Israel's Messiah, we'll again understand why things happen the way they do. For example, in verses 1 through 5, a message comes to him from the two sisters of Lazarus informing him Lazarus is fatally ill. The intent of the message was for him to come quickly to Bethany and heal Lazarus before death takes him. You anticipate reading that when he heard about the illness, he did depart for Bethany, but that is not what happens. And verse 6 says, when therefore, when what for? For the very reason he heard that he was sick, he abode at that time 2 days in the place where he was. For the very reason he heard about the illness, he does not go anywhere. It would only be a one-day walk geographically from where he was now to get to Bethany, but he doesn't go anywhere. He stays put where he is. And in verse 16, only after hearing about the death of Lazarus does he begin moving towards Bethany in verse 16, but even so, he moves rather slow. So by the time he gets to Bethany, Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. But the mention of 4 days of deadness is significant from the Jewish frame of reference, because the common teaching among the rabbis of first century Israel was, when a person dies, the spirit hovers over the body for 3 days. And soon those 3 days of hovering, there was a small possibility of a resuscitation. But at the end of the 3rd day, the spirit descends down into Sheol, and from then on, a resuscitation is impossible. Only by miracle of resurrection can the person live again. And so Jesus set the stage in such a way. They will not be able to explain this away by mere resuscitation, because by the time he arrives into Bethany, Lazarus has been dead for 4 days, 1 day too many, for a resuscitation to occur. And often in the commentaries, they mostly focus, and sometimes only focus, on him showing his love for Mary and Martha, which no doubt that is part of it. But it's always wise to look in the context to see what the exact reason is. Now skip down to verse 42. For whom was Lazarus primarily being raised? Chapter 11, verse 42, and I know that you hear me always, but because of the multitude that stand around, I said it, that they may believe, that there's the multitude, they may believe that you did send me. And so the primary purpose of raising Lazarus is for the benefit of the masses, for the benefit of the multitude, the one sign he promised to give them. And when this sign is given, they will need to respond. And so in the verse 44, Lazarus is resurrected and the first sign of Jonah is given. And in verse 45 and 46, we see the responses, 2 different responses. In verse 45, notice many Jewish people respond correctly and do believe. But in verse 46, many others still belaboring under the same leadership context. Report was occurred to the Pharisees. And the Pharisees know that this is the sign he promised to give them, because he was speaking to them when he gave him that sign. So verse 47, the chief priests therefore and the Pharisees, this would be the Sanhedrin meeting, to come together for the purpose of responding to this first sign of Jonah. In the course of their deliberations, they decide to go 1 step further beyond what happened in Matthew 12. In Matthew 12, they rejected him on the grounds of being demonized. And now in chapter 11, they go a step further and decide to put him to death. So verse 53 says, so from that day they took counsel they might put him to death. And this decision to put him to death begins filtering down to the masses. So verse 57 says, "Now the chief priests and the Pharisees had given commandment that if any man knew who he was, he should show it, that they might take him." And with this action, the first sign of Jonah is officially rejected. Now let's go to the book of Luke, chapter 19. The context of what we're about to read is in the context of the triumphal entry, and myriads, thousands upon thousands of Jews are conducting Jesus into the city and crying out, "Hosanna," more correct, "Hosanna, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord." And from the Jewish context of that day, that was the official messianic greeting. And rabbis were teaching that whenever the Messiah comes, he must be welcomed with these words, for they are come from Messianic Psalm in the Hebrew Bible, Psalm 118 and verse 26. And so by saying these very words, they were claiming him to be the Messiah. And one might think that conditions could still change, except for the fact that the unpardonable sin has already been committed. And because of its unpardonableness, no amount of repenting can change the fact of coming physical judgment. So right in the context of messianic acclamations, when the Messiah speaks in verses 41 through 44, these are verses we read last night, I won't repeat the reading, but he points out the city is still under judgment, and the city is still destined to be destroyed with a temple, not one stone upon another, because they did not know the time of their visitation, did not realize messianic times had come, and they have failed to recognize it and failed to accept him as the messianic king, and therefore they shall not receive the Messiah in this generation. And so in the context of messianic acclamations, the words of the Messiah are words of judgment. Let's go back to Matthew's gospel, and we'll look at Matthew chapter 23. This whole chapter only has one theme, and that is the renunciation of the leadership of Israel of that day. He pronounces seven woes upon the spiritual leaders, and while there are a variety of different sins, they form a circle because the first woe and then the seventh woe will deal with the very same sin. And the first woe is in verse 13. "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because you shut the kingdom of heaven against men, for ye enter not in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entering in to enter." And they're condemned here for two reasons. First of all, they are rejecting his messianic claims. But secondly, they also lead the nation to reject those messianic claims as well. And what he says in the first woe elaborates with the seventh woe in verses 29 through 36. And in the seventh woe, he pronounces they'll be held accountable not only for the rejection of his messiahship, they'll be held accountable for rejecting all the prophets of the Hebrew Bible. Because everything the prophets were going to say about the coming of the Messiah had now been said, and the Hebrew scriptures had been closed for about 4.5 centuries. So to reject his messiahship is to reject the prophets as well, and no Jewish person can claim, even among the most orthodox among the Jewish people, can claim that they believe the prophets and yet reject his messiahship. It's a package deal. To believe the prophets is to believe him. To reject him is to reject the prophets. Now keep in mind, the Hebrew Bible, he used it, is in the order of the Jewish Bibles to this day, not in the same order as the Christian Old Testament. The number of books is the same, but the order of the books is not the same. The first book is the same, Genesis, but the last book is not Malachi, but 2 Chronicles. Now notice in verse 35, he mentions two men, Abel and Zechariah. Abel is found in the first book, Genesis, and the Zechariah mentioned here is found in 2 Chronicles. And by naming these two men, he says you'll be held accountable for everything from Genesis to 2 Chronicles. A Jewish figure of speech, meaning the whole body, are revealed divine truth, much as we would say from Genesis to Revelation, our figure of speech for the whole body of divine truth. And now look at verse 36. Verse 36, "Verily I say unto you, all these things shall come upon," and those two words are there again, "this generation." This generation guilty of the unpardonable sin will be held accountable of the whole body of revealed written truth. A few days after these words were spoken came the second sign of Jonah, the resurrection of the Messiah, but that will be rejected in the first seven chapters of the book of Acts. And the stoning of Stephen in Acts 7 marks the official rejection of the Messiahship of Jesus. And that's why only as of Acts 8 does the gospel for the first time go out to non-Jews. After chapter 7 remain within the Jewish world alone. The point that I made so far is this. It was leadership of Israel that led the nation to reject his Messiahship. In light of that, then, exactly what is the precondition to the second coming? What is the one condition that must be fulfilled before the Messiah can return? And there are many scriptures on this. For reasons of time, if I turn to page 2 of your outlines, the backside, we'll look at 5 key passages beginning in Leviticus chapter 26. Leviticus 26. Leviticus 26, Moses outlines will end up being Jewish history. When he first wrote it, it was all prophecy. Most of this chapter has been fulfilled in the course of and the sweep of Jewish history. He points out when the Jewish people enter the land, they'll fall into periods of disobedience. They'll bring on different forms of divine discipline. First will come subjugation, fulfilled in the days of the judges. Secondly will come captivity, fulfilled by the Assyrian and Babylonian captivities. But then will come a worldwide dispersion, which will come as a direct result of rejecting the prophet like unto Moses. But at the end of verse 39, the worldwide dispersion of the Jewish people is a fact. And by the end of verse 39, all of the elements of these has now history been fulfilled. But Moses continues to write in verse 40, "They shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers in the trespass which they trespassed against me. And also that they were contrary unto me, also were contrary unto them, and brought them into the land of their enemies. If then their uncircumcised heart be humbled, and they then accept of the punishment their iniquity, then will I remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac, also my covenant with Abraham will I remember, and I will remember the land." And in verse 42, God says through Moses that God has every intent of fulfilling every promise that's found in the Abrahamic covenant, and especially as it pertains to the borders of the promised land. But the fulfillment of enjoying all of the covenantal promises, to enjoy all the promised land, is conditioned by verse 40. They must confess the iniquity of their fathers as well as their own. The word iniquity is singular, committed by their fathers or their ancestors and continued by them. But the point he makes, there's one specific sin that must be confessed before they can enjoy the full fulfillment of the benefits of the Abrahamic covenant and finally be able to settle in all of the promised land and live in peace. Now let's move on to Jeremiah chapter 3. Jeremiah chapter 3. In Jeremiah chapter 3, verses 14 through 18, Jeremiah lists some of the blessings the Jewish people enjoy in the Messianic kingdom. In verse 14, they'll be brought back into land one by one till every Jew is back in the land. In verse 15, "In that day he'll give them righteous shepherds, righteous leaders that will feed them with knowledge and understanding and never be guilty of leading them astray." In verse 16, they won't so much as think of rebuilding the Ark of the Covenant, because in verse 17, God himself in the person of the Messiah will be ruling them from the city of Jerusalem. And in verse 18, they'll be so reunited, so they'll never be split into two Jewish kingdoms again. But the enjoyment of all of these millennial or messianic kingdom conditions of verses 14 through 18 are preconditioned by verse 13. "Only confess your iniquity." but you have transgressed against Jehovah your God. And again, the word iniquity is singular and specific. There's one specific sin that must be confessed before they can enjoy these many blessings of the Messianic kingdom. Now we'll move on to Zechariah chapter 12. The last three chapters of Zechariah are one unit, one prophetic discourse God gave the prophet. And chapter 13 focuses on the forgiveness of the sins of Israel. And chapter 14 speaks of two more things. In verses 1 through 15, he describes the second coming. And in verses 16 through 21, he describes the Messianic kingdom. However, the second coming and kingdom of chapter 14 and the forgiveness of sins of chapter 13 is preconditioned by chapter 12, verse 10. And I'll pour upon the house of David, upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the spirit of grace and supplication. They shall look unto me whom they have pierced. They shall mourn for him as one mourns for his son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one is in bitterness for his firstborn. Before there can be a cleansing of the sins of Israel, before there can be a second coming kingdom, what must happen first is Israel looking unto the one whom they once pierced. They must mourn for him as one mourns for only son. In other words, until chapter 12, verse 10 is fulfilled, the prophecies of chapters 13 and 14 cannot be fulfilled. Let's go to the first minor prophet, Hosea chapter 5. Hosea chapter 5. Throughout the fifth chapter of Hosea, God is doing the speaking, and God is still speaking as we come to verse 15, where God says, I will go and return to my place until they confess their offense and seek my face. In their affliction, they shall seek me earnestly. Before one can return to a place, he must first leave it. After leaving a place, he could then return to it. Now, God's place is heaven. And so before he can return to heaven, he must first leave it. And when did he ever leave heaven? He left heaven at the incarnation. We became man in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. But then because of an offense committed against him, the word offense is both singular and specific. Because of one specific offense committed against him, he returned to heaven in his ascension to the Mount of Olives. He goes on to point out he will not come back to the earth until this offense is confessed, adding the warning, in their affliction they will seek me earnestly. Now, what is the national Jewish offense against the Messiah? Not so much in killing him. Actually, the killing was done by Roman soldiers. The Jewish offense, as we saw in the first hour, is rejecting him on the grounds of being demonized. Until that specific offense is confessed, there can be no second coming. Now keep your finger, he'll be coming back to this passage momentarily. Let's go to the fifth passage, which is Matthew chapter 23. Matthew 23. Matthew 23 in verse 37, he summarizes his three-year ministry to Israel. How often he longed to spread his hands out and give the city the messianic protection that was predicted by the prophets of Israel. But the verse ends at the end of verse 37, but ye would not, they wilted not when they rejected him. And so now in verse 38, their house, the Jewish temple, will lie desolate. It'll be destroyed 40 years after these words are spoken. But then notice verse 39. If I say unto you, you shall not see me henceforth till ye shall say, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. As I mentioned a few moments ago, this is the official messianic greeting. They will not welcome him until, unless they say these words. And the point he's making is this. Just as years ago the Jewish leaders led the nation to reject his messiahship, a day will have to come when the Jewish leaders will lead the nation to accept his messiahship. So the basis of the precondition of second coming involves two elements. Number one, Israel must confess her national sin, which is rejecting him on the grounds of being demonized. But secondly, they must plead for Messiah to return, to mourn for him as one mourns for his son. Until these two things occur, there will be no second coming. Now let's go back to Hosea and look at chapter 6. This is one of those places where chapter got divided at an unfortunate start, because the first three verses of chapter 6 belong with chapter 5, and the new context begins only in chapter 6, verse 4. And as we read verse 15 a few moments ago, he points out he won't come back to the earth until they ask him to, warning also that in their affliction they will seek him earnestly. And verses 1, 2, and 3 is the response to 5:15. The words are the words of a call or a decree calling to national repentance, which would be issued by leaders. Come, let us return unto Jehovah, for he hath torn and he will heal us. He hath smitten and he will bind us up. After 2 days will he revive us. On the third day he will raise us up and we shall live before him. Let us know, let us follow on to know the Lord has gone forth to show us the morning. He will come unto us as the rain, as the latter rain that waters the earth. In the closing days of the tribulation, in connection with Armageddon, which is the affliction of 5:15, the leadership of Israel finally discover why they have suffered all these things and what they need to do and what they need to do in response. At that point, they will issue this call to national repentance. And when this call is issued, that will begin the last 3 days before the second coming. For the first 2 days, they'll confess the national sin using the words on your outline, Isaiah 53, verses 1 through 9. Isaiah 53 is one of the most detailed prophecies about the Messiah's death, resurrection, and so on. But it's more than that. As you read the first 9 verses, you notice this is Israel of a future generation confessing the sin of failing to recognize him, and confessing that when he was here first, they thought he was suffering for his own sins, and now they realize he was suffering for their sins. And so Isaiah 53, verses 1 through 9, will be the national confession of Israel's sins. I won't detail the chapter. You can do this on your own. But the second element is the plea for the Messiah to return. And the words of the pleading are found in the last three passages on your outline, Isaiah 64, Psalm 79, and Psalm 80. We'll look just briefly at Psalm 80, so let's turn to it. Now the theme of the whole psalm is in verses 1 through 3. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, you that lead Joseph like a flock, you that sits above the cherubim, shine forth before Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh, stir up your might and come to save us. Turn us again, O God, and cause your face to shine, and we shall be saved. And this is the theme of the whole psalm, praying to God, the God of Israel, to rescue them from a dangerous predicament. As we keep reading, we'll notice exactly whom they're asking for. Let the still addressing his prayer to God, and look at verse 17. Verse 17, let your hand be upon the man of your right hand, upon thee, son of man, who you made strong for yourself. The one they're asking for deliverance is the one that was now at the right hand of God. There's none other than Yeshua, than Jesus the Messiah, who's been sitting there ever since his ascension from the Mount of Olives. He's called the Son of Man, which was one of his messianic titles. But they will come at the Jewish request for him to do so. He'll raise himself from the seed, return to the Jewish people, and finally bring about these conditions to an end and bring in the messianic kingdom. Now, if we fully understand the precondition of the second coming, we understand three important things. First of all, we understand the biblical foundations of the satanic animosity towards the Jews and why there is always worldwide anti-Semitism, even in places where no Jews live. Satan knows that once the Messiah returns, his career will be over with. He also understands there will be no second coming until the Jewish people ask him to come back. So if he can succeed in destroying the Jewish people once and for all, there'll be no second coming. And then the Satan's curse will be safe forever. That's why he's always had this animosity against the Jews. That's why things like the Crusades occurred. That's why things like the Russian pogroms occurred. That's why the Nazi Holocaust occurred. And that's why Revelation chapter 12 says that once Satan is confined to the earth, in the second half of the tribulation. He knows his time is short, only 3.5 years before the second coming. And knowing his time is short, he organizes all of his satanic powers, energies for a worldwide Nazi-like situation to try to annihilate every Jew living at that point of time. And anti-Semitism, whether it's national or religious, whether it's economic, whether it's political, whether it's religious or even theological, is just part of the satanic goal to annihilate the Jewish people. A second thing to understand is why Satan has used one name more than any other name in Jewish history to persecute and kill Jews. Since the 4th century, 95% of the persecutions against the Jews were in the name of those three C's: the church, the cross, and Christ. Satan knows the name they need to call upon to bring him back, and so he's organized a strategy to make the name odious in the Jewish community. And the name has become odious, but most Jewish people know nothing about the Jesus of Scripture. They're reacting to the Jesus of Jewish and church history. And this was part of the satanic strategy to keep the Jews from coming to their Messiah. Now, third, understand the importance of Jewish evangelism and why we must be actively both involved in supporting Jewish ministries, because part of Jewish missions in our witnessing, we have to separate the Messiah of Scripture from the Christ of church history. And until the Jewish mind can make that separation, it'll be very difficult for him to begin considering the claims of Jesus being the Messiah. And therefore, Jewish ministries must continue. There are some so-called evangelical associations today that are very actively doing nice things for the Jewish people, even raising tons of money to help Jews move to Israel, but they follow a strict policy never to witness to the Jewish people that they help. They claim that this was how God led them, but they fall into Satan's trap. And Satan can even use certain those who call themselves evangelical, just not evangelistic, that they fail to, by policy, to share the gospel with Jewish people. And that's the kind of ministries that the Bible believer needs to reject. It's okay to do good things for Jews, it's okay to help move Israel, but the key element is not their temporal abode, but their eternal abode, which apart from the fact that he's the Messiah, they will not gain. And therefore must always continue actively proclaiming the gospel to Jewish people. In the first session, when we dealt mostly with certain Jewish elements of the Gospels, I showed you a couple of books. On the prophetic scale, you find this book is called The Footsteps of the Messiah. It covers all the prophecies of the Bible in both Testaments, and it puts the prophecies in a chronological sequence. You can tell in what order these prophecies will be fulfilled. So there is a sequential study of all the prophetic events, but in the back are a number of appendices giving a lot more additional information, which is available from the side room. Let me close with another rabbi story I hope you enjoy. A lot of people come to my meetings only for these stories. A rabbi was having trouble with his teeth. Went to the dentist and got the problem fixed, but the problem kept coming back. And so after several visits, the dentist says, "Rabbi, if we keep doing it this way, it'll become more and more expensive as we proceed. Let me give you what I think is a better option for you. Let me pull out your bad teeth and I'll fix you a good set of dentures. It's expensive at the front end, but long term it's going to save you a lot of money." And Rabbi agreed and had the procedure done. Now, synagogue service, the way it's conducted in the Orthodox synagogue, is just the reading from the Torah, the Law of Moses, followed by a reading from the prophets, and the rabbi will expound on some part of the passage he read for about 30 or 40 minutes. But on the Sabbath after that procedure, he spoke only for 5 minutes and he just suddenly quit. The next Sabbath, he spoke for 10 minutes and he suddenly quit. And the third Sabbath, he got up and began speaking, and he kept on talking and talking and talking for about four, close to 5 hours. Didn't even stop to breathe, just kept on talking. Afterwards, the elders of the synagogue pulled him aside and said, "Rabbi, we have to talk to you. We don't know what's been happening to you. The last two Sabbaths, you were far too short, but this morning, this was terribly way too long." Rabbi explained what happened. He says, "Well, 2 weeks ago, after my procedure, After my 5 minutes, my gums began to hurt. They had to quit. Last week, I was getting used to my new dentures. They weren't quite fitting right, and after about 10 minutes, they began to slip. I had to quit. What happened this morning is I got up, and I wasn't paying close attention, and by accident, I put in my wife's dentures, and I could not stop talking.
Thank you.